Alrighty, so welcome to your pH and buffers lab. So I'm Vanessa, your instructor again. I'm gonna go ahead and show you how you're gonna go ahead and conduct your pH and buffers lab next week. So before we do anything, number one, pull out that lab assignment. Follow along with me. I am on page one. Page one, right away, there's a safety note. There are a lot of safety concerns with this lab. That is why you should be watching this video ahead of time. So the big safety notes, I may paraphrase them up here a little bit. Number one, caution, you should be wearing goggles at all times, okay? And matter of fact, I need to put on their goggles and gloves. I don't know why I did not. So goggles and gloves at all times. Never mix acids or bases with anything else than what we've told you to do, okay? That is very, very important. The next thing, always add acids to water. And so never go the other way around. Don't put acids into water. Don't put water into acids. You put the acids into the water. It's like the alphabet, A's before W. So A to W, that's a great way to remember that. It can cause, if you go the way around, it could cause splatter, it could cause burns and so forth. The next safety caution concern is never mix strong acids. An example of strong acid, hydrochloric acid, okay? Never mix it with a strong base. Strong base is sodium hydroxide. Matter of fact, I need you to know in this experiment, we won't mix those at all. There's nothing on there that says to put HCl and NaOH together. So it's going to be your responsibility to always be looking at the labels of what you're using and to know exactly what it is that you're supposed to be using. If you ever have any questions, you just ask. All right, next, don't get it on your clothes or your skin. If you get drops on your clothes, it could burn through your clothes causing holes and it can burn to the skin underneath. So let somebody know and we will make sure to neutralize you accordingly. The first thing for neutralization is not to run to the sink. If you have acids on you, we need to neutralize that with baking soda. If you have bases on you, we need to neutralize that with citric acid. So always know what it is that you are working with. This is very important in this lab. Next, neutralizing spills. If you drop anything on the counter, on your table, on your books, you shouldn't have your books out for this one either. If you drop anything, don't just wipe it up because the nature of HCl and NaOH, it looks like water. And since it looks like water, it wipes up like water, but the chemicals that are in that solution are still on that surface. So if you drop HCl on there and you wipe it up and you put your arms on it, you're going to have burns all up and down your arms. So it's very, very important. Any tiny little droplets that you make, you need to let me know what it was that you dropped. And then that way we can go ahead and neutralize it and clean it accordingly. All right, next, neutralize before disposal. We want to be very careful that we're not just putting anything and everything down the sink. We want to make sure that it is of a specific pH. We have to bring the pH down or up depending upon what it is. And really, it's bringing the pH up to make sure. That is the big one. We do not want to put acid down the sink. So I ask that every group check with me first. And the first thing I'm going to say, what's the pH? And then, so make sure you've tested the pH. All right, so we can move on. Also, broken glass. Glassware happens, broken glassware does happen in this lab. So be very, very careful with the glassware. The nice thing is the gloves give us a little bit more of a stickiness sometimes. Post-lab cleanup. You're going to discard your Kim Whites, your used pH paper, disposable gloves, disposable pipettes. Actually, we will not be using the pH paper for this lab. We're going to go ahead and take that little piece out. Make sure you turn off your lab quests. These are your lab quests, and wipe them clean because there might be spillage on those also. And we're going to run 50 milliliters of DI water in our burette. This is our burette right here. Okay, this is what we're going to be using for our main experiment. So I'm going to go ahead and go to the next pages. Page two talks about the lab purpose. I'll let you read that on your own for the moment. I'm going to slide through. Also talks about the nature of water and the nature of when water releases a hydrogen, how it will increase the acidity of a solution. I want to refer you to page 3, the pH scale. Okay, so your pH scale on page 3, 0 hydrochloric acid is an example of that, and we will have that, although we will not be using a very strong concentration of hydrochloric acid. Sodium hydroxide. Sodium hydroxide is the strongest base. It is 14. So neutral is 7. So this is something that you covered in your chemistry chapter. So make sure, if you are not sure about the nature of water and the pH scale and buffers, that you have reviewed your chapter 2 chemistry chapter. Alrighty. So what we're going to do here today in this lab is we are going to illustrate the nature of several solutions, whether they are a good buffer or they're not a good buffer. And so what a good buffer is, a good buffer can give off hydrogens and take back hydrogens as necessary, as needed. So the example of a good buffer is carbonic acid. Carbonic acid is a chemical that is made with the combination of carbon dioxide and water. And so when carbon dioxide and water get together, such as carbon dioxide from the air and being absorbed in ocean water, that carbon dioxide can disassociate, break off an H, and let those H free float around in that water system, thereby causing the water to be more acid. So that's ocean acidification. And so your carbonic acid can pull in those hydrogens as necessary too. You will see these happen in body systems such as blood. When you have too much CO2 that is being held inside the blood and is not being exhaled out or excreted by the kidneys as needed, you'll learn more about that in A&P. It could cause acidification of the blood, which can cause a lot of problems because your blood should be about pH about 7.4. Alrighty. So with that, there are some substances, some solutions that are not good buffers. For example, strong acids and strong bases are not good buffers. Hydrochloric acid is the strongest acid. Hydrochloric acid, when put in a water solution, will disassociate, break apart into the chloride atom, chloride ion, which is going to be an anion, and the hydrogen ion, which is going to be the cation. Because this is the strongest base, they don't have an affinity to try to get back together. They'd like to stay disassociated. So they are not good buffers. And then sodium hydroxide. Same thing, that is the strongest base, pH of 14, while this is a pH of 0 to 1. They will disassociate when put in a water solution, causing the OH to be the anion and the sodium to be the cation. They do not have the affinity to get back together. Okay, so with that, in this lab, we are going to illustrate the ability for certain solutions to either be a good buffer or not. We're going to work with four. We're going to work with water. We are going to work with a phosphate solution. We're going to work with sodium chloride, which is salt water. And then we're also going to work with milk. And we're going to illustrate whether those four solutions have the ability to be good buffers or not. So before we do any of this, let's go ahead and turn to page 4. On page 4, you're going to need to calibrate your pH meter. So your pH meter is this here. So I've already plugged it in to my LabQuest app. You should plug it in, let it sit for 90 seconds, so that way the LabQuest app can, computer can go ahead and recognize the new equipment that is with it. We have our gloves, we have our goggles, just like such. I'm gonna put these here just for the moment. All right, so this pH meter is in a standard solution. It has to be stored in it. You want to be careful not to turn it on its side because it will leak out. And you want to make sure you always, when this is not in use, put it into the storage solution, okay? Because the ball inside will dry out and get brittle. So what we need to do in order to calibrate our pH meter, we have three standard solutions. We have a standard solution that is a pH of 4, and it's pink, a standard solution that is a pH of 7, and it is yellow, and a standard pH solution that is a pH of 10. So what we're going to do, we're going to go ahead and glove up, goggle up, pull out little beakers, 50 milliliter beakers. There we go. That should be good. Excuse me. So when you are calibrating your pH meter to your LabQuest app, every time you switch this pH meter to a new solution, you have to clean it thoroughly. Okay? So let's go ahead and open it up. I screwed and then I pulled out. When it comes out of the solution, you have to be careful not to spill this. It happens all the time. I'm just going to go ahead and put it in one of these little beakers that's not being used because it helps keep from getting it tipped over. You clean it with your DI water. You want to clean it thoroughly everywhere. Get up in the center around the glass ball. That is a glass ball in there, and it is very, very sensitive, so be careful with it. Do not break the ball. They do go back broken sometimes, but not in my class because I make sure to warn people not to break the ball. All right, so when you are, just follow the instructions on that page that I told you. What you're going to need to do, you need to pour a little bit. Oh, I'm sorry, not pour. Ha, you caught me. Pipette a little bit using a different pipette for each solution into the small beaker. Probably somewhere just below the 10 milliliter mark. You don't need to do a lot. We're not trying to waste here. Okay. That's about good enough. This can be thrown away. Make sure you close up all your solutions to avoid spillage. I'll just leave this here. Open up your LabQuest. You can use your stylus. Oh, I think I turned mine off already. Mine is sitting and thinking. So while it sits and think, I'll just go ahead and give you some more. I'm going to put this into the... Actually, I'll just put it into the standard solution. I'll have to clean it again. Okay. Waiting for the LabQuest app to wake up. Hopefully it wakes up the way it's supposed to. Make sure you are putting some solution in there. Boop, 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 just like such. Different one, throw it away, and so forth. Okay, so the whole purpose of these solutions is you are going to tell the computer, this is a pH of 4. Then you're going to tell the computer, this is a pH of 7. Then that's calibrated. Then what you're going to do is you are going to use the pH of 4, pouring in here, to check whether or not it is calibrated correctly. All right, it woke up. So, let's try it again. And clean it off thoroughly. Yes, the water gets on the counter. Just have some paper towels handy. Dab the ball, put that to the side. Don't ever touch your face with gloved hands like that. I didn't. All right, so you're going to go ahead and put this in. Now, go to your file sensors. So what you're going to do is go to sensors. Okay, it's at the top menu. When you go to sensors, you click on calibrate. Then you hit the channel 1. Okay, there's only one option at that point. Then you're going to go ahead and hit calibrate now. But before you hit calibrate, why don't you check to make sure the 1-point calibration is not connected? So calibrate now. I've already been holding this here, so it's been stabilizing. So my voltage is pretty stable. So I'm going to go ahead, now that my voltage is stabilized, I'm going to go ahead and hit number 4. My pH is 4 because that's what this pink standard solution is. So essentially I'm telling the computer that is what a pH of 4 looks like. So once you do that, you're going to hit keep, pull it out of the pH of 4, clean it off thoroughly. Just like such. Then, remember I have the yellow stuff in here. I put this in here, and then I tell it what the number 2 value is after the voltage has stabilized. Pretty stable. Let's go ahead and let it know that it is a pH of 7. So, it's a pH of 7. Now I hit keep, and then I hit OK. Boom. Clean it off. And so forth. Then you're going to take your pH of 10, remember there's blue juice in here, you're going to put it right such, and look at your meter. It should say somewhere around 10. It should be 10, maybe 10.5, 10.50, or it could be 9.5 or 9, well actually 9.50. If it's too close to the 9 bottom number, call me over, we'll talk about it, okay? So it's going to toggle back and forth around the 10 area, and it will never stop, okay? It's not going to stop stabilizing. The reason why is because the water that makes up this solution, the hydrogens and the hydroxides, are constantly breaking apart and disassociating and getting together and breaking apart. So what that does is it causes the pH to change because it sees the monitor will feel free-floating hydrogens, thereby decreasing that pH and making it show more acidic. But then they get back together, more basic, more acidic. But it should be somewhere around 10. Alrighty, so now that you've done that, I'm going to go ahead and put this, clean it first before putting it away. I've already cleaned it, but I'm going to go ahead and clean it in your presence. Put it back into the storage solution. Tighten it up. Make sure it does not tip over. So put it in a corner somewhere for it to stay. There you go. Alrighty. Got a little water mess here. So the next thing that we're going to do is we are going to get our solutions ready using the burette. So make sure your solutions are put up. I'm going to go ahead and put this to the side. I'll clean it in when I'm finished. So the next thing you're going to do is set up your experiment. So we have a burette stand here. The burette is the glass thing that you see here. And here is the stand. This is your hot plate, but please be very, very careful. Do not turn on the heat, okay? We are using it for the stir function, not the heat. So make sure you're watching that your partner doesn't turn on the heat, and you make sure you, as a partner, make sure they're not turning on the heat, okay? So I'm going to go ahead and place this out here. We have two different beakers. We have what I've already shown you is the waste beaker. And then we have the working beaker, okay? So you're going to put the working beaker underneath the burette. Make sure you are lowering it all the way down as such. Then we are going to put sodium hydroxide into the burette. Make sure you have the funnel at the top. I'm only 5'2". This is iffy. Because if it splashed, it could splash in my eyes. So number one, no climbing on counters, no climbing on chairs. Get it low as you can, remove the hot plate, and then choose your tallest person to get this done, okay? If everybody in your group is just still can't quite reach, just make sure that you're kind of step back and that your eyes are protected. That's very, very, very important. I'm not actually going to be wasting any solution or pouring any solution, but double check that you are using sodium hydroxide to pour in there. So what I'm looking at, I'm going to go to the procedures so you can follow along. Page 5, number 1, lets you know. Go ahead and make sure you got your gloves and your goggles on. That is a definite for this lab. Here is your burette on your burette stand. You have your working beaker, the burette lowered into it. We're going to go ahead and fill, like I started to show you, with 50 milliliters of sodium hydroxide. With that, before, make sure your stopcock is perpendicular to the burette stand. That means it's stopped. If you find that it's welling over, like it's coming out, what that means is maybe this has been loosened, and also we might have a broken seal in there. So before you start, number one, don't mess with it. Just call me over. I will do the adjustments for you. Okay, so when you're looking at your burette, it says 50 milliliters down here, it says 0 milliliters up here. So when it's all the way to the top, that is 50 milliliters. So once you've poured it in, I want you to go ahead and slowly let a little bit out. This is a great opportunity to feel what it's like to let a little bit out. You want to make sure that all of the, that it actually comes to the tip. There you go, and then stop it back up. Now, you might have fallen below the 50 milliliters. So if it's not at the zero, you might have fallen to the one. That's okay. It's okay. You don't have to fill it up. Just make sure you write down your starting level. And your starting level, if this from 50 to zero is 50 milliliters, but you start at the one, you are starting at 49 milliliters. Okay? Alrighty, so our first procedure is going to be using water. So if you want to go ahead and follow, if you want to look at your step-by-step process, I'm just going to speak it. Just know I'm going over that process of what the experiment is. I'm going to refer you now to the tables. So looking at page 8, you have table 1, table 2. We are not going to do the procedures for table 1. Okay, so we're getting started looking at table 2. The first thing that we're going to be doing is the water, okay? So remember, I'm not wasting materials, I'm not putting water in this, but you would have put 50 milliliters of water using your graduated cylinder. This is your 100 milliliter graduated cylinder. You just fill it up to 50. Do not do it according to the beaker. When you do it according to the beaker, the accuracy is not the same. And the reason why is because of the diameter of the beaker versus the diameter of the graduated cylinder. So this is going to be your equipment that is going to have the best accuracy. So you pour your deionized water, 50 milliliters, into your graduated cylinder. Place that into the beaker. You want to make sure that your stir is going at all times. Now, I'm not going to leave mine going because I don't have any water in here and I don't want it to fall off. So as you're doing your stir, you're going to do it at moderate speed. Moderate speed is a speed that it is going constantly, but it's not shaking around. So we want to make sure the beaker is not shaking around, because if it does shake, smash, you end up with broken glass. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and turn it off. You will keep your stir going at all times. So once you have that there, you want to make sure that you are testing your pH of your water. You want your water pH to be right about 4. So here's the deal. The pH of a pure water should be 7. The pH of the water that we get here on campus is probably going to be somewhere around 8. It just has to do with their deionizing system, and that's just the way it is. So you take your pH probe. You're going to go ahead, always clean it off. You clean it before and after. I know I may have already said this. Before and after going to a substance. All right, got that nice and clean. Dry it off. Your pH probe has already been calibrated. Once it has been calibrated, do not mess with the calibration. Okay, so you will have this stir going. You will have this in your pH probe in the water. And let it go ahead and test. When you look at your lab quest, you're probably going to see it's around 8. We want to get that pH to around 3. So in order to do that, what you're going to need to do is you're going to need to adjust the pH by adding a drop, maybe 2, of hydrochloric acid. We're going to go ahead and add drops of hydrochloric acid. There we go. Nice little droppers. Make sure that this is only specific to the HCl that you are adding, okay? Now, very carefully, I need you to, when you add your drops, you're not adding it from over here and coming over here. You take your test tube holder along with your test tubes right near your beaker. Put it in there, grab a little bit of a drop, just a little bit, not up into the bulb. Grab a little bit, boop, put a little in. Now, before you do anything further, what you're going to do is you are going to be continuously testing your pH. As you can see, this is a two-man job. One person's doing the dropping, the other person is testing the pH. Let the stir go ahead and stir the water with the new drop of hydrochloric acid. You might find that it's gone down to possibly a 5. If it hasn't hit a 3 yet, you get to add one more drop of hydrochloric acid, okay? All right, so after you've done that, make sure all the drops of hydrochloric acid are in your test tube. Then you may throw this pipette away. All righty, so you have this. You got your pH set to about a pH of 3. Make sure you always have your test tubes covered. Now we can go ahead and get started. So, as we get started, you have groups of two. One person is holding on to the pH probe at all times, okay? The other one is doing the adjustments on the burette. So we want to make sure that we're not doing this, okay? We never leave this unattended, one hand on it at all times. So, while one person has their hand on it, I'm going to go ahead and remove because I'm only one person. The other person is making sure that the burette tip is inside the beaker. You've already adjusted it to make sure that all of the sodium hydroxide is down and ready to go. You have already looked to verify what the starting milliliters is. On your table 2, I want you to write that starting milliliter down. Also on table 2, next to it, the pH, you write down what the current pH is. Now you may begin your procedure. So the person who is in charge of the burette is going to be very slowly opening the stopcock and allowing just a little bit out. They're just trying to get a half a milliliter. I do understand and know that in your procedures it says 1 milliliter at a time. I'm telling you, I want you to go a half a milliliter at a time. Otherwise, you're going to be done within 1 or 2 tries, probably even 1. So let a half a milliliter out at a time. Once you've let a half a milliliter out, the person who is checking the pH, they are going to go ahead and see what the new pH is. Allow it to stir. This pH will never stay still, so don't sit there and wait for one number to stay still. It is to count to 3 Mississippi, grab a number and write it down, okay? Then the other person is going to let another half a mil out. The person using the pH probe, count to 3 Mississippi, grab a number, they write it down. You're probably going to be finished with this experiment in the course of 3 let outs, so really about 1.5 milliliters. Now, I'm not trying to stop you, but the whole premise is you want to stop when your solution has changed pHs by 3 pHs. Well, I'm just letting you know you started at 3 and it's going to skyrocket up to 11 within 1 or 2 tries, okay? Even if it skyrockets on the first try, at least do 2 more. All right, so when you're finished with this, that is filling out your table 2, and that is the water. So what you're going to do, do not throw out this sodium hydroxide. The sodium hydroxide that you have put in here is to be used for the entire experiment. We don't keep adding more, and we don't get rid of this and refill it up. Okay, so one person will go wash this out sufficiently. The pH is going to be somewhere around 11. You can turn on the water, let the water run, and slowly drizzle into the water. Okay, that is what you can do. While that person is doing the cleanup, the other person is getting started on the next one. And the next one that you are going to do as far as your table 3 is going to be your phosphate solution. So phosphate solution, you're going to go ahead and measure it out, 50 milliliters. Once Your partner comes back with a clean beaker. They're going to pour that 50 milliliters into the clean beaker, place it up underneath, lower the burette at all times. If you keep this up here, you might have splash. And this is sodium hydroxide. It is the strongest base. We're working with a low concentration of it, but it is a still strong base, and it can still damage cells on your skin, and especially your eyes. So you lower it down. You want to make sure it's in, but not near the stir, because you don't want it to get broken. So you're going to do the same procedure, except do not adjust the pH with hydrochloric acid. That was only to be done in the first procedure with the water. You will not use the hydrochloric acid on any of the other ones. So when it comes to the phosphate buffer, you have your phosphate buffer in your beaker. You are going to let out. First, you get your start point. Write it down on your table 3. You're going to go ahead and let out, for this one, 1 milliliter at a time. You're going to let out 1 milliliter at a time until you've done about a quarter of the table. Then you're going to start letting out 2 milliliters at a time until you've done another quarter of the table. Then you're going to start letting out 3 milliliters at a time. And that's pretty much going to get you 3/4 of the table done. By that time, you should have had a change of pH from the original to the ending, about 3 pHs. If you haven't, go ahead and call it, okay? So just make sure 1 mil, 2 mil, then 3 mil, a quarter of the table, a quarter of the table, a quarter of the table. All you're doing is illustrating the ability for the phosphate to receive sodium hydroxide but withstand its changes in its own pH. Okay? So when you're finished with that, one of your group members is cleaning that out. That can go down the sink with plenty of running water. This was already cleaned out. Goes down the sink with plenty of running water. Once you have clean equipment, you can work on the third one. So that would be table 2, 3, 4. Table 4 is the sodium chloride. Same thing, 50 milliliters of sodium chloride, clean equipment, put it into here, 50 milliliters of sodium chloride. Go through the same procedure for the sodium chloride, 1 milliliter at a time, just 1 milliliter at a time. You're probably going to change pHs pretty fast. So last one, but not least, clean it out, is going to be skim milk. Skim milk is going to come from the refrigerator. I don't have it here. 50 milliliters of skim milk. You're going to pour it in. Boom, boom, boom. Do the exact same thing. But here's the deal. With the skim milk, I want you to treat it the same way you did the phosphate. Okay? So which means 1 milliliter at a time for a quarter of the table. 2 milliliters at the time for another quarter of the table. 3 milliliters at a time for the last, for a quarter of the table. Once you've got 3/4 of the table done, go ahead and call it, okay? What you're illustrating is milk's ability to uptake hydrogens and release hydrogens as necessary. I'll let you fill in the blanks from there. So that is going to complete all of your procedures. When it comes to your cleanup, here's what you need to do. You are going to get your waste beaker. Partner will be cleaning this equipment because it had the milk in it. You're going to get your waste beaker. Lower your burette all the way in. Do your stopcock completely up and down. Just allow all of the sodium hydroxide to come out. Okay. Once all of this sodium hydroxide comes out, go ahead and stopper it up. With that sodium hydroxide, that pH is going to be 11. You may take that sodium hydroxide and slowly drizzle it down the sink with running water. There should be much more water going down the sink with drizzles of sodium hydroxide, okay? So the next thing is bring your beaker back. I'm actually going to remove my stirring apparatus so that way I can lower it down. Lower it all the way down. Put your funnel back in. You should be stopped off perpendicular. You're going to completely fill this up all the way to 50 milliliters and just run it through. Okay, you should do that 2 times. Preferably 3 times, but if we're time intensive, at least 2 times. And that along with the cleaning of these with the drizzling of the water. And then when you have that all cleaned out, you rinse it. Then you soap and water wash it using your brushes, both of those. And that will be the same thing for your waste beaker, soap and water washes. All of your plastic pipettes can be thrown in the trash. You want to make sure any glassware that you use has been soap and water washed. Alrighty, so I hope you guys have fun.